Please be seated. Good evening. Welcome to our final Wednesday Lenten service. Nice sunny evening out. Are there any announcements or prayer requests from the congregation at this time? Okay, let us pray. O God, who reward the merits of the just and offer pardon to sinners who do penance, have mercy, we pray, on those who call upon you, that the admission of our guilt may serve to obtain your pardon for our sins. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever, Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Grant us your forgiveness. We know that this whole journey is about our reconciliation. We know that God wants to forgive us. We know we're preparing to renew our baptismal promises and refuse to be mastered by sin. Today we hear the invitation asked more earnestly. In the marvelous discourse that follows the sign of healing, Jesus says, I am not seeking my own will, but the will of him who sent me. We are filled with a sense of sorrow and gratitude as we see what he did for us. Lord, in your mercy, let us give thanks to God our Father through the power of the Spirit. He purifies our heart and strengthens us in love. Let us humbly ask him, Lord, give us your Holy Spirit. Help us to receive good things from your bounty with a deep sense of gratitude and to accept with patience the evil that comes to us. Teach us to be loving not only in great and exceptional moments, but above all in the ordinary events of daily life. May we abstain from what we do not really need and help our brothers and sisters in distress. May we bear the wounds of your Son, for through his body he gave us life. Lord, in your mercy. Loving and merciful God, we are so aware of our sins and weaknesses, but as painfully aware of our faults as we are, let us also remember your tender love, your gentle and limitless forgiveness. We come before you filled with pain and guilt, but look into your eyes and see the forgiving love we so long for in our life. Help us forgive the same way. Teach us to love as you love. Lord, in your mercy. May the Lord bless us, protect us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Today's lessons are based upon Genesis chapter 14. In the days of Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Elasar, Chedorlaomer, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of Goim, these kings made war with Bera, king of Sodom, Birsa, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Admah, Shemeber, king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela, that is Zor. And all these joined forces in the valley of Siddim, that is the Salt Sea. 12 years they served Chedorlaomer, but in the 30th year they rebelled. 13th year they rebelled. In the 14th year, Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him came and defeated the Rephaim, Nashtaroth, Karnaim, the Zuzim and Ham, the Emim and Shavah Kirithim, and the Horites in their hill country of Seir as far as El Paran on the border of the wilderness. Then they turned back and came to Mishpat, that is Kadesh, and defeated all the country of the Amalekites. Also the Amorites were dwelling in Hazazon Tamar. Then the king of Sodom, the king of Gomorrah, the king of Admah, the king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela, that is Zor, went out and they joined battle in the valley of Siddim with Chedorlaomer, king of Elam, battle king of Goim, Amraphel, king of Shinar, and Arioch, king of Elasar, 4 kings against 5. Now the valley of Siddim was full of bitumen pits. As the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled, some fell unto them, and the rest fled to the hill country. And so the enemy took all the possessions of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their provisions and went their way. They also took Lot, the son of Abram's brother, who was dwelling in Sodom, and his possessions, and went their way. And one who escaped came and told Abram the Hebrew, who was living with the oaks by the oaks of Mamre the Amorite, brother Eshcol and of Aner. These were allies of Abram. When Abram heard that his kinsmen had been taken, he led forth his trained men, born in his house, 318 of them, and went in pursuit as far as Dan. And he divided his forces against them by night, he and his servants, and defeated them and pursued them to Hobah, north of Damascus. Then he brought back all the possessions and brought back his kinsman Lot with his possessions and the women and the people. After his return from the deed of Chedorlaomer and the kings were with him, the king of Sodom went out to meet him at the valley of Shavah, that is the king's valley. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. And he blessed him and said, "Blessed be Abram by God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand." And Abram gave him a tenth of everything. The king of Sodom said to Abram, "Give me the persons, but take the goods for yourself." But Abram said, "The king of Sodom, I have left in my hand to the Lord, Most God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, that I would not take a thread or a sandal strap or anything that is yours, lest you should say, 'I have made Abram rich.' I will take nothing but what the young men have eaten and the share of the men who went with me. Let Adner, Eshcol, and Aunt Mamre take their share." Now, Genesis 14 is about war, but it's also a tale of redemption of a man for his king, his nephew from captivity. I relate to this scenario because my oldest sister was married and had started her family before I was born. My oldest nephew is 7 months older than him, but our relationship is closer than that of uncle and nephew. The question I asked myself, if I would rescue him from a bad decision. Now, the background for this text is from Genesis 13, 5, verses 5 through 13. Lot also, who went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. Now, the land was not able to support them, that they might dwell together, for the possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. The Canaanites and the Perizzites then dwelt in the land. So Abram said to Lot, "Please let there be no strife between you and me, and between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brethren. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you take the left, then I will go to the right. Or if you go to the right, then I will go to the left." So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the people of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. Now you think about the scenario. Lot was given first choice or first refusal, the choice where he wanted to live, not just his flocks, but his family, and chose to live somewhere, Sodom, which had a wicked reputation. Remember, his choice was freely made. Think about this scene in Genesis this way. There could be a family in eastern Crawford County where the family farm was not big enough to support the families of two brothers. So one of them buys a farm on the west side of the county. His family grows, he prospers, and one day he comes to a family reunion wearing royal blue and gray, much to the chagrin of the family, which has deep roots in New Washington or North Robinson or Bussars or Crestline or Guyon or wherever. Is he still a welcome member of the family? If you are the brother who stayed on the original family farm, and if his car breaks down on their way to a sporting event where both brothers have children playing, would you stop and help them? Now, that's not an exact analogy, but you get the drift of here. These guys had their choices made for them. They made free the choice of where they want to live. Now, as I was thinking about this text and Abram's response, I thought of two passages. The first from Genesis 4:1-9, where God confronts Cain about Abel's whereabouts. Now, Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, "I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord." And again, she bore his brother Abel. Now, Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel also brought the firstborn of his flock of their fat portions, and the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why has your face fallen? If you will do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. His desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it." Cain spoke to Abel's brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" Now the second is the parable of the Good Samaritan from Luke chapter 10, verses 30 through 37. In reply, Jesus said a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, where he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. And a priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil on wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Now which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The expert in law replied, the one who had mercy on him. So we're bookending what Abram is doing with, am I my brother's keeper, and who is the neighbor of the fallen person? So the question to me is not, am I my brother's keeper, or am I the neighbor, but what do I do when I'm confronted by my brethren's need? Now, brethren literally means brothers. It also refers to members of the same religious community. Now, my personal reaction to someone in trouble is, you dug your hole, get yourself out of it. That is a harsh reaction. But that's reality sometimes. So referring back to Genesis 13, verses 12, Lot has chosen to live in Sodom, which has a bad reputation. So not only does Abram ransom Lot, Lot then goes back to Sodom, and once again, Abram has to rescue Lot and his family from God's wrath over Sodom and Gomorrah. Not once, but twice he does this. We are baptized into the faith, confirmed into the faith, and celebrate being a part of the family of Christ through Jesus' death and resurrection. We are bought by the blood of Christ into eternal life. How do we celebrate? How do we live our life when we are called by need to ransom a fellow member of the family of God? Do we ask, are we our brother's keeper? Are we by empathy the neighbor, or are we like Abram, the redeemer of our called brethren? In today's reading from Genesis, a war is being fought. Brothers are in trouble. A ransom is made, but Abram stands above the fray in his decision-making. He asks for no recompense, just for the return of his nephew from captivity. Where are we in that area between, am I my brother's keeper, am I the neighbor, or am I a true brother in faith? Are we willing to aid, to redeem those of our brothers and sisters in Christ who are in trouble? In this season of Lent, let us think, let us live in the journey Jesus makes to redeem us so that we can become of the family of God, become as brethren in Christ. Amen. Please rise for the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again, Lord. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. Look for the resurrection of the dead. In the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Let us close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.